cold or warm inside. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I'm very excited for the snow that's coming down outside. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If there's one thing that I enjoy, it is when the snow falls. And one of the reasons is because...
You can come to my house and shovel it.
You cannot but help. As the snow has fallen, to begin to reflect on what Christ wants to do in your life. You know, in Jamaica, New York, where I was born and raised, at the end of business day, the street is filthy. It is nasty. And when you wake up, you know, the next day, you know, during my elementary days, I would wake up and 7 o'clock, you're walking on the street, you see all these rodents, you see trash and everything all over the place. But when it snows, it seems that it's the most beautiful place you could ever go.
It's true.
And Christ wants to pour his righteousness upon us to make us whiter than snow. Amen. So you cannot but help to appreciate and love the snow and reflect on what Christ wants to do for you. Right this time, we'll get into our announcements. Tomorrow afternoon, we're moving our Sabbath afternoon study from 4 to 3. So we'll start at 3 o'clock and it'll go to 4 o'clock. And tomorrow's topic, we're discussing on the theme of toxic emotions. And so we're looking at Daniel chapter 7. Last week was part 1. This week will be part 2 of Daniel chapter 7, toxic emotion, the theme. So it's in Bullet Hall, room 150. Afterwards, if what is going to be taking place, if you go to the next slide, there is a series that is taking place called Conquering the Battle Plan for Purity. And so what this is, if you know anyone who is struggling with purity, whether they have an addiction, whether it's pornography, whether it's yourself, or you want to find out different resources to help that person, this is what's taking place in the Nubo Auditorium. So it's right across from N150, and that is taking place at 5 p.m. So that's the reason we move our...
You mean 4?
Yes, thank you. So that's the reason we moved our study 1 hour earlier. So we encourage you guys to come out, and you can go back to the other slide. So Sunday, we're going to continue with our care group. Care group is the time where we get together, we study. This year we're just looking through the book of Luke, we fellowship together, and we just have a wonderful time in the Lord. Thursdays from 7 to 7:30 in Rose Chapel we meet. That is when we have our prayer meeting. It's time we just pray together, and we read a few passages from Hope and Daily Living. So we encourage you guys to come out. All right, and that is all for our announcements, and we wish you a wonderful, lovely Sabbath.
Amen.
Good evening. It's good to be here. So I'm coming a long way away, just from South Bend, Indiana. And I've really been blessed by your theme. The Comforter has come. I really like that theme. I'm sure you've looked at John 16:13 many times. We'll kind of use this as our scripture reading. John 16 and verse 13. We'll spend a little bit of time in this chapter, as well as some others. Because, however, when He, the Spirit of Truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth. For
Amen.
Okay. So it was a day in January, a very warm day in January, actually, and 3 a.m., my alarm clock goes off, and all the adrenaline and cortisol surges through, and I'm like ready to study for another, you know, 12, 14 hours. I was in my first year of medical school, and loving all of the barrage of information, but this was in Southern California, much warmer than this particular January here, and it was surrounded by the San Gregorio Mountains on this side, and then the Los Angeles National Forest with its gigantic peaks on that side, and then the sprawling Los Angeles with the Pacific Ocean on that side. It was gorgeous, but yet indeed, all the mountains surrounding me and the sea on the other side reminded me of another time in the Bible, you know, when the children of Israel at the Red Sea. This particular January, I definitely felt like I was at the Red Sea with no way out. I could have been doing a million things with my life at that point. You could have already been a missionary, you know, to some DD group of people somewhere. I could have been doing a nice lazy 9-to-5 job, a million different things, right? But no, I thought God had led me in this way, and here I was. At that point, as first year of medical school, I was failing one class and almost failing another, and struggling to keep up with everything. And, you know, I'd gone through undergrad, you know, taking multiple science classes at a time and working and doing ministry at the same time, and came up with the best study system in the world, or so I thought. Here I was, not, you know, feeling like I was failing the Lord in what He had called me to do. And I could hardly have time to think of also my grandfather was not doing well, very poorly in health. That really ate away, because I couldn't be there for him. And indeed, that Friday morning, right before my week of testing, kind of very pivotal week of testing, I received word that, you know, he had passed away. So that Sabbath, obviously, was kind of a downer Sabbath for sure. My faith was really being tested, and some friends and I went hiking, and we were coming down a hill, which there they actually have legit hills. I'm a Michigander, so I can make fun of Michigan. But we're coming down, and my leg went this way, and my body went that way, and it just, my knee felt horrible, and it was swelling instantly. I'm like, no, my meniscus. And one of the tests that we had to do the next week was actually like a physical exam, like clinical exam, where they would be like watching us. So here I was like on crutches trying to pretend I was a doctor. And it was, you know, added to the challenge. And I was like, Lord, where's the Daniel principle now? You know, I prayed, Lord, please don't let me get into medical school unless I'll be better physically, mentally, and spiritually. You know, I'm trying, you know, I'm exercising, I'm sleeping, I'm eating right, which is a challenge in medical school, but it's very possible. And, you know, where's the Daniel principle now? You know, where are your promises? God had to show me another depth to his principles and to his promises that I didn't realize, that I was using my own skill and expecting God's promises to be fulfilled. Second story, very similar, and think about the similarities of how the Holy Spirit's leading in these two stories. Turn to Mark 4:35 and follow along as the gentle breeze is walking across the company of men, women, and children, awestruck by Christ and his teaching. Then imagine from Christ's perspective, you know, he's criticized at every side from the Pharisees. He's, you know, all these people who really don't understand his mission are just kind of, you know, gawking, and you know, people that he has healed are just praising him. And finally, you know, at the end of the long day, he says, let's pass over to the other side. The disciples are kind of rowing across the calm, glassy sea. And maybe it was Peter who, like, you know, experienced fishermen, is like, that cloud is a bad one. And sure enough, it whips the sea into a lather. And but I'm sure they worked well together. They are experienced fishermen. And then they start bailing a bunch of water. And I was like, come on, John. We do this all the time. What's the problem? Very quickly, I mean, just what can they do to even keep the boat facing the waves and feeling like the boat's going to splinter at any second? And right at the peak of their crisis, you know, this bolt of lightning seems like it's going to just take them out, and it illuminates the face of Christ, who's still in the boat. And, you know, instead of, they could have reacted many different ways, right? We'd be like, why? You know, we're all going to die together. Master, why do we perish? You know, we're going to perish. Do you not care? Of course he cared. He cared a ton. An incredible amount. But he was waiting for the critical, teachable moment in their crisis. Clearly, it wasn't his crisis. He was sleeping peacefully. And gets up and with the calm of a million glassy seas of Galilee, there's peace be still. And you know, perhaps the disciples at that moment, through that experience, learned more than the entire day of teaching that they didn't even really comprehend at that point in their experience with Christ. When they learned that their skill and their independence didn't jive with how the Christian walk works. And he drives us home, this point home a little bit more when he says, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? So consider for a moment, what was the role of the Holy Spirit in these two stories? And how is the Holy Spirit trying to lead in your life? What is the Holy Spirit trying to show you through the experiences that you're going through? So back to John. How does the Holy Spirit lead? John 16, 7 through 11. Verse 8, talking about the helper who would come. John 16 and verse 8, I hope you brought your Bibles or your electronic Bibles. It says, and when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. The Holy Spirit at work. Convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. So the work of the Holy Spirit, convicting us of sin, convicting us in these moments in our lives, and bringing us into this experience of righteousness and then the message of the judgment. You know, certainly us knowledge-limited, time-limited humans will never know everything there is to know about the Godhead, but very clearly we can see in these verses that God is the Holy Spirit is playing a role in our salvation. It's our privilege to understand how that role works. And over in Hebrews 12, we'll go there a little bit later, verse 25 says, see that you refuse not him who speaks. When the Holy Spirit speaks to our hearts and convicts us, see that you refuse not him who speaks. For if they, the Israelites, the wicked are out there, right? Refusing the Holy Spirit's leading. I work with them in my line of work, right? In the ER and things like that. And actually, I've learned the most from people who are hardened in sin. I was like, wow, when I have a divine appointment with them and start talking with them of how they're struggling and full of guilt and how the Lord is guiding them, I'm like, whoa, this is kind of what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell me right now in certain areas of my life. And indeed, what does Jeremiah 17:9 say? That the heart is deceitful above all things. Who can know it? Desperately wicked. So there is no peace, says the Lord, unto the wicked. The disciples clearly had no peace in their time. When they were in the boat, and Christ certainly did. It's great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Psalm 119:165. So maybe there's something deeper we can learn about the Holy Spirit's work in our life and the peace that the work of the Holy Spirit can bring, especially when we face difficult circumstances or think we're failing the Lord. Turn with me to Isaiah 30. Isaiah chapter 30, and we'll start in verse 15. Isaiah 30 and verse 15 says, "For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest you shall be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. But you would not. And you said, no, we will flee on horses, therefore you shall flee. And we will ride on swift horses, therefore those who pursue you shall be swift. 1,000 shall flee at the threat of one, and at the threat of five you shall flee. To you are left as a pole on top of a mountain and as a banner on a hill. Therefore will the Lord wait, that he may be gracious to you, and therefore he will be exalted, that he may have mercy on you. For the Lord is a God of justice." Verse 15 is talking about this peace, returning, quietness, rest. God is longing for us to have. It will bring about what? It will bring about strength. But the Israelites were like, no. We will flee upon horses. What are they fleeing at? I mean, verse 17 says, 1,000 shall flee at the threat of one. I mean, from God's perspective, like, what are you fleeing from? You're just this one person? What are you doing? And you're going to flee on swift horses. Okay, well, your worst fears will be realized. Those who pursue you will be swift. But then there's some people that don't, they're left as a pole on a mountain and a banner on a hill. So the people who flee, how many times have we viewed our crises as, like, whoa, this is crazy. The disciples viewed the storm. Like, I viewed, everything that was happening in medical school at the time. Whereas, what was God's perspective in those times? What we should be asking ourselves when we're facing a storm, not how big the storm is, but what is God's perspective on how the storm is, and how this crisis is, and how does he view this obstacle? It's a very different perspective. Perspective of faith, right? And those who God says to stay and not to flee, be left as a beacon on the hill. And what is his promise to those people? It says, therefore, those that are left as a banner on the hill, therefore, the Lord will wait. Wait. I don't want to be left in a crisis and like the Lord waiting, but how many times do we see in the scripture when those who felt like they followed the Lord's will have been left waiting? John the Baptist in prison, the Red Sea, Sarah who's barren of children. The list goes on. But what happened through those experiences? The Lord was then gracious to them.
to wait on the Lord and wait for the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Because what will be the result of that? Eternity and rest, you should be saved, and quietness and confidence should be your strength. There's a strength that comes with waiting on the Lord, and that's what he tells us to do through difficult experiences. And then what happens? And therefore, he will be exalted. As we wait on him and go through this experience with him, he will be exalted. And have mercy on you. The Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are those who wait for him. There's this really unique interplay of the human and the divine in this whole passage. And I don't think we have complete time to go through this little chart, but on your own you can go through this passage or many other passages in Scripture and ask, in this passage of Scripture, what do I do? You know, what is the Lord telling me to do? He's telling me to return and rest, to wait on the Lord. Later in these verses it says to cry unto the Lord, verse 19, and verse 21, to listen to the word behind you. And then what does he do in this passage? Very fascinating. How does this the interplay of the human and the divine work? Very interesting, as in verse 20 and 21, it says, verse 20, and though the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your teachers will not be moved into a corner anymore, but your eyes shall see your teachers. Your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk ye in it, whenever you turn to the right hand or whenever you turn to the left. So we always quote that scripture oftentimes, but the context is just beautiful. The context of this, you know, waiting on the Lord through experiences and how that faith-building experience builds confidence and strength in him. And then, you know, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. But wait, verse 20 has a very unique, another clue to how the interplay of the human and the divine works. It said, the bread of adversity and water of affliction. Bread of adversity and the water of affliction. What on earth is that doing there? So turn over to Hebrews 12 to kind of see a similar chain of a similar vein of thought in Hebrews 12. We already were there, you know, earlier when we talked about not refusing when the Holy Spirit speaks to us in verse 25. But everything before verse 25 really teaches us how not to refuse the Holy Spirit's speaking to us. So, starting in verse 1, I'm going to read quite a little passage here in Scripture. It says in verse 1, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily ensnare us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. human fathers which corrected us and we paid them respect, shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed, for a few days, chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening seems to be joyful for the moment, indeed, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. You read about peace and quietness and confidence and of righteousness in these other passages. And you read about this bread of adversity and water of affliction in these other passages. And it explains it a little bit more in detail, like, wow, this is actually something that we experience. Like, this is part of God's plan that, yes, the words of Scripture, but it's also the experience in our daily life of when we're coming into contact with sin, either, you know, externally, or we come in contact with an experience that brings out the sinfulness of our own soul, that there's this friction and this chastening, and the Holy Spirit is like putting it up on our face. I mean, how many, at least I've noticed this, maybe you have, that it seems like, you know, every time, you know, I get into some sort of obstacle, it seems like kind of the same, I get into the same mindset, or the same mind traps, or, you know, the similar things seem to come up again and again. Well, maybe there's a reason. Maybe the Holy Spirit is trying to speak to us and bring the words of Scripture alive into our experience. And will we listen? Will we listen to what is the providences that the Holy Spirit is trying to bring us into our lives? So, very fascinating, very fascinating passage. It's interesting that this passage, that Hebrews 12, comes after Hebrews 11. Thankfully, I can do simple math. But Hebrews 11 is the hall of faith. How do you think they had that much faith? They were, I think the answer is in verse 11, they had the peaceful fruit of righteousness because they were trained by it, or exercised by it, like going to the gym and working out a muscle, having experiences with Christ and listening to the Holy Spirit and learning how to wrestle with the Holy Spirit. In our devotions, in our daily walk with the Lord, builds this muscle called faith. When we decide, no, I'm going to return and wrestle to the Lord and go to my knees and ask for victory over this issue. I'm going to go to my knees and ask, why on earth is this happening? Is there something in the Scriptures that explains why this is taking place, or that addresses this issue? And pour out my heart, your heart, to the Lord, and hide nothing. I'm telling you that if you submit to this process of chastening and listening to the Holy Spirit, you will learn how to wrestle with the Lord and come out victorious. On the other side of full surrender, there is full blessings, full peace, peace that passes understanding, like Christ had when he stood up in the boat. I mean, that doesn't happen in a moment. He came as our example to show us how to live a Christian life. To live this journey. He actually explains it in more detail, example in more detail in Hebrews 5 and verse 7. Turn with me to Hebrews 5 and verse 7. It says, we're talking about Christ, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications, vehement cries and tears, to him who was able to save him from death, and was heard because of his godly fear. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by what? By things he suffered. And so Christ went through this very same process that Hebrews 12 is describing God has ordained for you and I. And it's not it's a purging process. Interestingly, after the description of that heart work that we read in Isaiah 30, 15 through 21 is a description of events leading up to the second coming. In fact, it talks about, you know, things like the latter rain, and it's very, very fascinating. Isaiah 30 and verse 23, then he will give rain for your seed. Verse 27, 28 talks about the judgment of the Lord. Verse 29 says, you shall have a song as in the night when a holy festival is kept. And verse 30, the Lord will cause his glorious voice to be heard. And it goes on discussing some of those events. So this is very hard work that needs to happen before the Lord can pour out his Holy Spirit. This deep surrender daily in our daily lives. This is the message we need to take into our very soul experience with the Lord before we can proclaim the three angels' messages with the power that will accompany it. Hosea 6 and verse 3. So Hosea 6 and verse 3 says, let us know, let us pursue the knowledge of the Lord. His going forth is established as the morning. He will come to us like the rain, like the latter and former rain to the earth. King James said, let us follow on to know the Lord. Follow on day by day to pursue that depth of experiential knowledge with the Lord. Where he can turn our seeming failures when we depend on our own strength into his successes. And his going forth is established as the morning. It's those little experiences. It's not like the noonday sun all of a sudden, but it's those daily experiences of surrendering and submitting to the Lord. So practically, you know, what does that look like? You know, that practically looks like taking your Bible in the morning and bringing up something to the Lord that's relevant right now, that you're wrestling with, that's a burden on your soul. You know, Psalm 68 says to pour out your heart before God, and, you know, hide nothing, and, you know, lay out your circumstances and your soul to God. Ask what is between your soul and your Savior, and not be off your knees until you have an answer, until you have peace in your soul. So back to Mark 4, with the disciples, you know, what did the disciples learn about the Holy Spirit's leading in their lives? They spent an entire, you know, 3.5 years with Jesus trying to learn this issue of not depending upon their own skill and experience, and learn how to work with the co-working of the human and the divine. Yeah, they, you know, we say, oh, take the Lord Jesus with you everywhere you go. They took Jesus with them into the boat, all right. But why don't we let God take us with him and through the experiences that he wants us to go on this journey with Christ? surrounded with an atmosphere of peace and light. He will receive an endowment of physical and mental strength. His life will breathe out a fragrance and will reveal a divine power that will reach men's hearts. A very powerful chapter, as well as Desire of Ages, page 668, and that entire chapter is very beautiful. So Christ, talking about Christ's example, we may also take hold of the strong for strength. We talked about the strength in Isaiah 30. We're not to place the responsibility of duty upon others, but the Lord will teach us our duty just as willingly as he will teach anybody else. Didn't John 16, 13 say that the Holy Spirit will guide us into all truth, and he will speak to us and show us things to come? If we come to him in faith, he will speak his ministries to us personally. Hearts will often burn within us as one draws nigh to commune with us as he did with Enoch. Those who decide to do nothing in any line that will displease God will know, after presenting their case before him, just what course to pursue. How many times do we depend on human wisdom and human counsel instead of going to the omnipotent God of the universe who has all the wisdom in the world for the answers and for guidance and for every issue in our lives? So just as we come to the end, will we refuse the Holy Spirit trying to speak through our experience and through the Word of God to us? Will we not covenant with God tonight to take something from the Scriptures and apply it to our souls? I encourage you to think about something you want to write down on these questions, specifically how to do that. Do you need to wrestle with the Lord about something? Is there a seemingly large obstacle that you'd like to understand God's perspective on this obstacle? Do you feel like you want to be the one fleeing at the rebuke of one? Or are you the one left standing and waiting upon the Lord? You need to learn how to wait on him. You need to submit to the chastening of the Lord. What is God calling you to do specifically tonight? So I invite you to write something, or if you don't have a pen, to think of something, write it on your phone. Very specific. We'll just take a few moments for quiet reflection for the next few moments, and then I will kneel and close with a word of prayer. Thank you. once again have mercy on us and gently